Welcome to episode 8.
Hey, this is John Lee Dumas of EO Fire, and you're listening to Who Did That Voice, where we take an in-depth look at voiceovers.
Are you ready to plan your next vacation getaway? Then I recommend using 3D Travel Company. They are more powerful than pixie dust, more fantastic than flu powder, and they never charge a fee. Whether you're booking a Disney or Universal vacation, a relaxing cruise, or a luxury trip overseas, you'll experience concierge-level service unmatched by any agency. From the moment you submit a complimentary quote request or inquiry on their website at www.3dtravelcompany.com, you'll find out what it means to be pampered by the best in the business. That's 3, the letter D, travelcompany.com. And tell them Trenton sent you.
Welcome to Who Did That Voice, the show where we take an in-depth look at voiceover. And now, here's your host, Trenton Larkin.
Hey everyone, and welcome to another episode of Who Did That Voice. Today on the show, we have Phil Lollar joining us today. Phil, thanks so much for joining us today.
Well, I'm very, very happy to be here, sir.
Well, Phil, would you please just give my listeners just a little bit of a background of who you are, how you became a director, producer, and writer, and how you got into the voiceover industry?
Wow, that's a lot of ground to cover. The voiceover industry is interesting. I've been an actor and doing acting stuff since I was about 5 years old. I used to love to perform for the family and even for local community groups. And then all the way through school and high school, I would act and perform in plays and musicals. There was a local theater company where I grew up in Tucson, Arizona, called the Southern Arizona Light Opera Company. Did a lot of work with them. And then came out to California to, you know, be a famous person. And when you come out to California and you try to get into the, at least it was in those days, it still is to a great degree, but, you know, people said, you got a unique look, go out there to California, you have a unique look. And I'd come out to California and I'd go to an audition, and this unique look that I had, 50 other guys had the same look. So it really became a matter of, well, am I going to be able to slog through all of this? You quickly realize also it's not what you know, but who you know. And I didn't know anybody. So I started writing at the same time. I was always writing throughout that process, but I never really considered writing to be something that I would do for a living until I was working at a film services company. And a friend of mine, who was a very good, strong Christian friend of mine, said, they're looking for a writer at Focus on the Family for the radio, a radio writer. He listened to Focus on the Family. I had no idea what Focus on the Family was. And I said, well, how do you write for the radio? What are you doing? He said, I don't know. They have a commercial on and they're looking for a writer. And so I had written a lot of stuff. I'd been through film school and written a lot of stuff at that point. And so I submitted some scripts and contacted to Steve Harris, who was the contact. He said, come on in. We talked and that's it. I started working at Focus on the Family. So that was really interesting to me because, you know, normally it's like I said, it's who you know. It's you get jobs because of who you know. And I knew nobody at Focus. That was a blind call. So that was strictly the Lord just saying, okay, I want you to go in that direction. And it was also very fortuitous in terms of the story of me, of the story of, you know, we all have our own stories. And the story of me at that point, I was completely unemployed and my wife was pregnant with our son. And so wow. It was a sort of poverty-stricken thing. And I'm like, okay, God, it's up to you, totally up to you. And just as a side note, it's very funny. I graduated from film school and I got a call one day from, again, I'm completely unemployed. I got a call from a guy who somebody had recommended me to do camera work for him. And I said, oh, this sounds great. And he's talked about how much it paid and it was great. And again, I'm completely unemployed. And at the end of the call, he said, okay, now this is for the adult film industry. Are you okay with that? And so it's this classic example of a moral dilemma. What do I do here? I'm unemployed and my wife is carrying our firstborn child and I'm desperate for money. And the first job that I get out of film school is for, you know, porn films. So what do I do? What am I going to do? And I said, well, I can't do that. I mean, I told him I couldn't do it. And I thought, well, you know, that's the way it is. If I have to starve or move back home or whatever it is, we'll do it. But then God honored that because it was just, I think it was just a month later that the Focus on the Family job happened. So God is good. So from there on, I as far as Odyssey was concerned, I always loved doing cartoon voices. when I was little, I was able to mimic a lot of the voices I heard on television. And I would sit there and television was my babysitter when I was little. I am a television generation guy, which is really interesting because now I don't really watch much television. But back then, I couldn't get enough of it. And I would sit there and mimic everybody that I could find, all the commercials, all the people on TV, and especially all the cartoons that were on. I'd mimic all the voices. And my mom used to sit me on a stool at parties and say, hey, just do that stuff we used to do around the house. And I'd just do all the voices and all the cartoons and stuff. And so I always wanted to do that. But then when I started working on Odyssey, when we started recording Odyssey, and we got people like Hal Smith and Walker Evanston and all these great, great, great voice actors, Will Ryan, KDD, all of these people who had really studied it and had been doing it for, in many cases, for years and years and years. Then I realized, wow, I got a lot to learn just about microphone theory and about how voices are shaped and formed and how all this stuff works. And what a great, I mean, it was really a wonderful, like, master's program in voice acting just to watch these folks and direct them and put them in, you know, they're in the studio and I'm watching how this works. And so from there, I started creating voices too. And then I wanted to be on my own program. I wanted to be on Odyssey in the worst way. So I was only able to be Randall the Odyssey mailman for a while. And then I created Dale Jacobs and said, I'm playing this part. This is me. I'm playing that guy. So then, you know, we were able to use Dale in a lot of different episodes and create a whole family around Dale. And that was a lot of fun. Did a lot of work with them. And then there were also tons and tons and tons. I say, you know, I always wanted to be on my own program. There were a lot of little ancillary voices, one and two line things that we just didn't have people to do. We hadn't hired any actors to perform them. And I would step in and do them. So in the original guide to Adventures in Odyssey that I wrote, they have a cast list in the very back of the book. And I was looking through it the other day and I went, wow, I played a whole lot of characters that I don't even remember on that program. So that's basically kind of how I got into it. And then, you know, from there you do meet people, then it becomes who you know. And I knew all of these other people. And so they would say, hey, come over here and do this and come over there and do that. And then through that you meet other people. And then pretty soon you're working on a lot of different things. And so Katie Lee and I were talking a couple of months ago about just how much stuff we've actually done aside from Odyssey together, how much work we've done on different programs. And it was something like almost 30 animated cartoons that between the two of us, we had worked on together. And it was like, wow, I didn't even remember most of these. You get to a certain age where you don't even remember them. And you go, wow, that's just startling. So,
wow, that is most fascinating. I know Katie had mentioned, you know, it's like a big scroll of paper unrolling in the King's Court and kind of finding out, wow, I did all that.
It is. It's really amazing because it doesn't seem like it at the time. You're just having fun and you're doing your work and it doesn't seem like a big deal. And then when you go back, I'll tell you what you really have to do. When you have to give somebody a resume and then you have to go back and you kind of put together everything. When you graduate from college, you create a curricula vitae if you're going to try to teach, which I do teach at Azusa Pacific University. But to get hired, they want to see your CV, your curricula vitae. And so I had to put one together, and mine ended up being 32 pages long.
Holy
I'm like,
cow.
What? Because they want everything. They want all of your experience. They want everything that you've ever done. They want to know what you've done and how you teach. And I'm like, I can't believe this. This is ridiculous. Because I had to, you have to rack your brain to remember all of this stuff. And then you remember, you put it down. It's like, wow, okay. I guess I've done a few things in my life.
Definitely. Well, Phil, as the co-creator of Adventures in Odyssey, how did the concept initially come about?
I was hired to create dramatic programming at Focus on the Family. That's what Steve Harris really hired me to do. And how that all came about was Dr. Dobson, at that point, was part of the whole, on the vanguard, basically, of the Christian culture movement at that point. And would have lots of various and sundry people on the program talking about popular culture, talking about culture in America at that point. And of course, you know, we've all heard the arguments, we've all heard the stories, we all know where culture is and what happens with culture and what is happening with culture. And at that point, there was a lot of rap music, a lot of bad stuff going on for kids, especially. There just wasn't anything out there that was really good and really wholesome. And Christians, of course, most of us have a very circle the wagons mentality when it comes to this sort of thing. Instead of engaging the culture, we sort of want to circle the wagons and fight against the culture and say, no, that stuff's not going to come in here. And rightfully so. I don't think that that's a bad thing. You have to be cautious. You have to be careful. But he had, Doc had a guy on his program named Bruce Wilkinson, who was with a group, I think, called Campus Crusade, or I don't remember exactly which group Bruce was with, but he was interviewing Bruce, and he said, and Bruce said, you know, it's not enough for us to just decry how bad the culture is without providing an alternative. If we don't provide an alternative, we're just kind of, you know, shouting in the wind. And he said, and Focus on the Family is in a unique position to provide an alternative. And that kind of got Doc's wheels turning, and everybody was thinking about it. So Steve Harris had written some audio dramas for the Focus on the Family broadcast and used Hal Smith and Chuck Bolte in them as actors. One was called Gone Fishing, and then there was a couple of other ones. And so Steve was in charge of the creative services department of the broadcasting division at Focus on the Family. And so naturally they're going to turn to him for new projects and whatnot. And so that's why he had advertised for a writer. And that's why I was hired. And so among the other things that I was doing at the time was creating this program, whatever this program was going to be. And so we batted it around. We were going to create a program come, you know, hell or high water. We were going to do it. And so we batted around a lot of ideas and went back and forth with it over and over again. And I wanted to do a variety show. I liked the old kind, you know, Carol Burnett, Red Skelton variety show type stuff. But Steve didn't want to do a variety show. He wanted something that was more narrative and more structured, more like a sitcom, but would offer drama as well. And so out of all of that came Family Portraits. And John Avery Whittaker in Wit's End was always, right from the very beginning, a part of that. And one of the things that I was really tasked to do at that point was, and I really insisted upon doing it, was one of my favorite writers was a guy who created Film Network and The Hospital. When he was writing stuff, he had to know everything there was to know about the stuff that he was doing, what he was creating, before he ever wrote any dialogue. All the characters, all the history of it. So all of that stuff had to be known by him. He thought, if I don't know this, how is anybody else going to know? How can I explain it to anybody else? So anyway, I figured I had to do the same type of thing. I had to know everything there was to know about Odyssey and John Avery Whittaker before I wrote anything about it. So I created the whole history of Odyssey and the whole history of Wit's End and the whole history of John Avery Whittaker before I wrote a word of dialogue for him. And but then that's basically how it came about. After that, we did Family Portraits. And then we tested it in 1987 for the first, I think, 3 months of the year, and got some good feedback from listeners. Said, yes, 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 please, give us more, give us more. And so Steve and I took whatever criticisms we also got from that and sort of revamped everything as much as we could and refined it. And then in November of 87, that's when we premiered Adventures in Odyssey.
Well, besides Adventures in Odyssey, I know that you also had a hand in a show called Jungle Jam and Friends, the radio show. And what roles did you play in that aspect, Phil?
Yeah, Jungle Jam came about because, just a little background, Nathan Carlson, who was on the Odyssey broadcast, Richard Maxwell was one of his characters, and a lot of other characters that he played, and Jeff Parker, who was Nathan and Jeff created Jungle Jam. They did a whole bunch of, they did some albums, record albums of Jungle Jam before I ever joined up with them. But we all worked on Odyssey together, and I said to Jeff, you know, we ought to turn Jungle Jam into a radio program too. And we thought, that's a great idea, that's a great idea. So we were able to get a little backing, and we did that. And I joined the cast as a writer first. I was writing some episodes for them. And then I think the first character I played was a character called Coyote, who was an Irish wolfhound. And then from there, I think there was Jean-Claude the Flying Squirrel. But the character that I'm best known for in Jungle Jam is Millard the Monkey. And so we've had a fun time doing Jungle Jam. I've never laughed so much in my life. It was by far the best writing and recording experiences that I've ever had, because we just laughed. I mean, I'm surprised we ever got any work done. We laughed so much.
Well, I know Adventures in Odyssey was very family-oriented, but with Jungle Jam and Friends, it was almost like listening to a Saturday morning cartoon with all the over-exaggerated voices and just the fun time it sounded like you guys did have on that show.
Oh, we had a blast. We really did. And we were really, again, it was one of those types of things that providentially we were brought together to create these little jewels called Jungle Jam episodes.
Well, is there a way that people can listen to Jungle Jam and Friends, the radio show? Is that available on Focus on the Family, or how do you listen to that show today?
Yeah, actually, you know, Jungle Jam was never a part of Focus on the Family. It was always its own separate entity.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so if you go to the Fancy Monkey website, I think it's just fancymonkey.com, you can find those episodes. They're there, and so are the Little Dogs on the Prairie videos, the Razzle Flabbins, and we did all of those shows separately from Focus, so they were never really a part of Focus. It's just that we all met through Focus, but then Jungle Jam was always a separate part of that.
Okay, I guess my understanding of thinking it came from Focus was just because of the tie it had with Adventures in Odyssey characters sometimes popping up on the show.
Right. We did do a lot of that, but that just kind of harkened back to the old days of early television.
Absolutely. Well, besides the different radio shows that you've been involved with, whether it be producing, directing, writing, or actually using your voice talents for, I know you've also been involved in animation such as the Tom and Jerry show. How did that whole thing come about?
Yeah, you know, the new Tom and Jerry show is being animated and produced by some good friends of mine. Their company, Renegade Animation. Daryl Van Sitters and Ashley Postlewaite are the executive producers. Daryl is a brilliant guy who worked with Warner Brothers years and years and years ago and helped revive their catalog. And he's just an animation expert and knows all about it. And so they were able to get the contract to do the new Tom and Jerry show. And I'd worked with Daryl and Ashley on multiple projects over the years. And so now I, you know, when this show came about, I said, hey, you know, if there's anything for me in it, I'd love to do it. And they said, well, as a matter of fact, I think we have something. And so that's kind of the way these things work out. And so I have this kind of minor recurring character called the Crooked Eddie, who's the stool pigeon. And he said he's got this kind of a voice where he talks like this all the time. Yeah, you know that guy. what was so much fun for me, just on a personal note, was one day, just about a month ago, I had a Tom and Jerry recording session. And then that afternoon, I also had, I play a couple of characters on a show called Space Racers. And that's a new cartoon show. It's out. The first season's out. We just wrapped the second season. It should be starting in the fall. I think it's on Sprout, NBC Sprout Network. So if you find Space Racers, go to it. I think also the first season's on Netflix, so you can watch that first season. I play a couple of characters on that show. And so I had this Tom and Jerry recording in the morning, and then had lunch. Katie Lee and I went to lunch, and then in the afternoon I went over and did Space Racers. And so often in our lives, you know, we go through our day-to-day routine and we don't really stop to think about how blessed we are. And after I finished the Space Racers recording, which was just a lot of fun to do, that's another really, really fun show, I was saying goodbye to everybody and leaving, and I stepped out the door, and then it dawned on me what kind of day I had just had. And I walked back into the booth where the director and producers and everybody of Space Racers was. And by the way, the episode of Space Racers that I was recording that afternoon was one that I had written for the show, too. So I walked back in and I said, guys, I just want to tell you about this day. First, I get up in the morning, I come out, and I record a recurring role in Tom and Jerry, which is an iconic series that I watched when I was a kid, and now I have a recurring role on. Then I have lunch with some of my favorite people in the world who are also voiceover actors. And then I come here and I record my script and my characters for another fun show that I hope one day will be an iconic show. It is not every day that somebody gets to live their childhood dreams. I just want to thank you guys for helping me live out my childhood dreams. This is remarkable. And, you know, thank God that I was able to notice it and that he blessed me to be able to see that. That to me was just amazing. I was so humbled and gratified and grateful to God that he would allow me to do that. So, you know, I just hope that, I mean, all of this sounds like I'm really, I don't mean to sound like I'm really bragging or anything. I think we actually are able to fulfill our childhood dreams in ways that we don't recognize when we're doing them. And I think that we just all need to be aware, more aware of our lives and how blessed we are, because we really are blessed, especially in this, even with all the bad stuff going on in our country right now, all the terrible, awful, rotten things that happen, we still are really blessed. And I just think we just need to be more grateful to God.
Well, that's an excellent word. I really appreciate you sharing that with us, Phil, because, you know, from going from that man that wasn't sure where he was going to find his next meal ticket to being able to live out your childhood dream, it's obvious that your life has been blessed. And it's a wonderful story that I think everyone will learn so much from, you know?
I hope so. I mean, I don't mean it to sound like bragging, and I don't want it to be that way, but I really want it to be that I hope we can see that we are blessed, how blessed we are, and that we should turn our hearts back to God. I mean, that's literally what this nation needs right now. I hear a lot of people saying, well, what's the solution to all these problems? How are we going to stop this? We need to stop this, and we need to, and they'll say things that even Jesus said, do unto others and things like that. But they've rejected Jesus. You know, you have the answer in front of you. Those things are really good things to say that Jesus said. They're really good things to say and try to do. But until you accept Jesus, they're not going to mean a whole lot. You know, we have to stop rejecting God. That's the answer. And until we do that, until we turn back to Him, I don't think the problems are going to get any better here.
Absolutely. Well, Phil, do you have any other current voiceover projects that you're working on that you'd like to share with us today?
Actually, I have a couple of things. Well, one big thing is I've got a new series that I'm producing that I wrote and produced called Iliad House, and it's a 6-part series. Hopefully, it'll go on beyond that. We did a little Kickstarter campaign for it about 3 years ago. Unfortunately, we didn't raise enough money to complete it, so I've had to actually put it on hold for a little bit in order to raise some more money, which I've done. And so now I'm back into completing it. The first 3 episodes are complete. I've got 3 more to go, and they are in various stages of completion. It's very, very close, and I'm really excited about it. It's a lot of fun. It deals with time travel, and it deals with a lot of the more mystical side of our lives. So it'll be very interesting to see the reaction to it, but it's a fun series, I think. For everybody, it deals with history and it deals with time travel and it deals with a lot of other very, very cool things. That's Iliad House, and I'm doing that one, but I'm also producing, I wrote it and produced it and directed it as well. So, this is a collaborative business, but in this instance, it was like, well, this is just a little old me this time. So we'll see, if it falls, if it fails, it'll fail completely. It's on my shoulders, and that's fine. I'm willing to accept that. But hopefully that'll be done by the end of the summer, if not sooner. And we'll get it out and get everybody a copy of it and see how they like it.
Well, absolutely. I can't wait to hear it, to listen to it and check out the content that you're producing, because it sounds like it would definitely be fascinating from the other works that you've done in the past. I know I would probably enjoy it.
Well, I hope so. It is a bit different. It's not overtly Christian. There's a Christian bent to it. And of course, the people who are producing it are Christians. It doesn't really have the message that say an Adventures in Odyssey episode would have at the end of it. But it does have Christian themes throughout it. And so it'll just be really interesting. Also deals with an episode, with an issue that's kind of a story beat that some folks shy away from in terms of, especially Christians, with its blatant time travel. And we have characters going back in time.
That's awesome. I've always loved time travel, like the time machine. You know, those movies were always very fascinating to me as a child.
We created the imagination station in order for us to do time travel, but it's still in the imagination. And Odyssey. And this time I said, I don't want to do the imaginary thing. I just want to try to see if we can make, how would it work if you really could travel through time? What would that do? And how do you solve the problems? There are a lot of paradoxes in time travel. If you read up on anything in terms of time travel or time travel literature, or even the physics of time travel, you see that there are a lot of paradoxes that are in there. And so I was trying to figure out in writing this script, how do I solve those paradoxes? How do I make those things actually work so that, it's plausible that if this were to be able to happen, then this would be the outcome. And so, you know, I don't know if I've solved them, but we'll see.
Well, that's very fascinating, you know, having to take all that time machine traveling mechanics into mindset of the writing. I'm sure that made it interesting.
Yeah, you know, this script is actually this script was actually my master's thesis.
Oh, wow.
FA. So I'd had it in mind for a long time, and when it came time to write the thesis, my thesis script, that was the one I wrote. It started out as a film script, and then I've adapted it to a 6-part audio drama. So yeah, I had to do a lot of research, and so part of my thesis actually is all the research that went into the time travel and the paradoxes and everything that happens in time travel, and how this script could solve those paradoxes. And so we'll see how that works. I'm sure that there are people who are way smarter about that sort of thing than I am. We're going to come back and go, nah, you still didn't do it. Sorry. But, you know, at least you'll be along for a fun ride, I hope.
Absolutely. I'm most excited to hear it and get to taste that new adventure that's going to be coming out soon. Well, besides all of the adventures that you've been on and that you've shared with us today, do you have a website or a way in which people can contact you, Phil, should they require your voiceover services?
You can always go to my Facebook page. It's just me, Phil Lollar, and you can contact me through my Facebook page, through, you know, the messaging service that Facebook offers, or on the Iliad House. There's an Iliad House Facebook page. You can go there and contact me through that. But those are basically the easiest ways to get a hold of me, because I'm looking on Facebook a lot. So you can contact me there. And if anybody, you know, from there, I'll be definitely be able to get back to you about stuff. Anybody wants to use me?
Well, Phil, I've got a couple questions for you before we finish out today. What is your favorite cartoon character and why?
Oh, my goodness. That's a really hard one. Well, I can tell you that at various times in my life, I really loved Heckle and Jekyll. And I really loved Mighty Mouse.
Oh, Mighty Mouse. That's an excellent one.
Yeah. And those were when I was very small. I remember Heckle and Jekyll and Mighty Mouse from being very small. From the Captain Kangaroo show, I loved Tom Terrific. I don't know if you're familiar with Tom Terrific, but he was awesome. And his Mighty Manfred the Wonder Dog. Tom Terrific and Mighty Manfred the Wonder Dog. They were great. And then as I got a little bit older, I do remember that on my fourth or fifth birthday, the one thing I wanted more than anything else was a Bugs Bunny doll. And I remember very distinctly having a Bugs Bunny doll. And it was one of those pull string dolls it was big. It was almost as big as I was. And you pull the string on it and it would go, I got back. It would, you know. So I played with that thing until it just finally fell apart. I remember that.
The last question I have for you today, Phil, is what is your favorite Disney movie and why?
Boy, that's another one that's really hard to think about. Let's see. If I had to pick a singular Disney film that was my favorite, would probably be Mary Poppins. And the reason why is because of the music. The music in Mary Poppins, the Sherman Brothers wrote songs in a way that nobody has ever written songs. Not just for Disney, but for anywhere. And the songs tell so much of that story to the point where they're so integral to the plot of the story that you can't really separate them out. And it's another film where you don't appreciate the technique of the acting, the technique of the filmmaking itself, until you're much older, until you've gone through it yourself and realized, wow, look at what they did here. Look at how they did this. It's really, really remarkable how they did a lot of the stuff that they did in that film. And so I think that would probably be the reason why Mary Poppins would probably be one of my favorite Disney film, I think.
Absolutely, Phil. Well, that is definitely one of my favorites as well. I love the music in that and how Dick Van Dyke's role is just so jovial and fun as well. So.
Yeah. And he's still going strong. Over 90 years old and he's still singing songs.
Yeah.
That's another one of those hail fellow well met guys. He's just this really great guy. I don't know if you've seen, there's a YouTube video out. He did a few years back when he was being interviewed on a different talk show or something, but he was in the green room and he was talking with people and everything. One of the people who was talking to him said, I understand that there were actual lyrics for the theme to the Dick Van Dyke show. And he said, oh yeah, there were lyrics. Maury Amsterdam wrote them. And they said, wow, that's amazing. He goes, you want to hear him? And they said, do you remember? He goes, of course I remember. And he sang the lyrics and Dyke Show right there, impromptu, boom, sang the lyrics. And they're wonderful.
That's
they're just
awesome.
Wonderful lyrics. So, I mean, look up that video. It's really great to see here. You hear Dick Van Dyke singing the lyrics to the Dick Van Dyke Show, the lyrics written by Maury Amsterdam. You go, how do you get any better than that? It's just wonderful.
That is awesome. Well, sir, we do appreciate your time today. Would you just give a close out today for us? Just tell people who you're listening to, and maybe you could pick a different voice for us, something from one of your new things or something from the past to close us out with.
Oh, this is Trent. Hi, Trenton. How are you today? This is the Mill of the Monkey here with Trenton Larkin. And it's, you know, who did that voice? Wow. Well, I'm kind of wondering that myself. So he's a great guy. And you're a wonderful, wonderful interviewer. And I really appreciate you having me on the program. And I'm going to say hi to all of my Jungle Jam friends for you. And we'll talk to you later. So goodbye, everybody. So long.
Hey everybody, this is a special shout out just for you, the listeners. You guys are so amazing. In under our first month, we reached over 1,000 downloads. It would not have been possible without each and every one of you listening and downloading, so thank you from the bottom of my heart. I also wanted to let you guys know I'll be in Marceline, Missouri, the boyhood hometown of Walt Disney himself. They have a thing there called Toonfest, and I'm going to be there, and I'd love to see you there too. It's September 17th in Marceline, Missouri. If you live nearby, or if you don't mind the drive, come and see me. Well, everyone, that's all the time we have for this episode. We'll see you next Friday with our next two special guests. It's a special week where we have Bill Rogers, the voice of Disneyland, and Camille Dixon, the voice of the California Adventure. Hey, are you ready to win some awesome prizes? All you have to do is like our Facebook page or follow us on Twitter for your chance to be instantly and automatically entered for your chance to win.
Thank you for joining us today. We'll see you next time for more discoveries on Who Did That Voice.